JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week April the 27th until May the 1st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, this week appears busy in terms of economic data and releases. There are four central banks on the calendar, with the Bank of Japan already deciding this morning. On Tuesday, it's the turn of the Riksbank. On Wednesday, we have the Fed, and on Thursday, the ECB. With regards to the data, we get preliminary GDPs for the first quarter from the US and the Eurozone, while from New Zealand and Australia, we have the quarter's employment and CPI reports respectively. Now let's start with today. Today, it appears to be a relatively light day in terms of economic data and releases, as the calendar is almost empty. The only important announcement is already made, and this was the Bank of Japan's monetary policy decision. The bank decided to expand its stimulus efforts to combat the economic fallout due to the coronavirus for the second straight month. Officials decided to increase the maximum amount of corporate bonds and commercial papers they are pledged to buy to 20 trillion from around 7 trillion yen previously. The bank also clarified its commitment to buy unlimited amounts of government bonds by removing the guidance with regards to purchases at an annual pace of 80 trillion yen. Now, on Tuesday, in the European session, the Riksbank takes its turn. On the 16th and 19th of March, the world's oldest central bank decided to extend its bond purchases this year by up to 300 billion SEC in order to mitigate the effects of the pandemic, while on March 26th, officials decided to initiate purchases of commercial paper issued by Swedish non-financial corporations. It appears that Swedish policymakers do not want to cut rates back into negative waters, and that's why they are expanding their purchases. Now, since then, inflation data showed that both the headline CPI and CPIF rates declined to 0.6% year over year, from 1%, while the core CPIF one, which excludes energy, ticked down to 1.5% year over year from 1.6%. Now, given that the slide in the core CPI rate was not as big as in the headline prints, we can confidently say that the headline declines were mostly due to the tumble in oil prices. This may allow officials to wait for a while more before deciding whether additional measures are needed, as they may prefer to wait and see whether the already adopted measures are having the desired effects. Now, later in the day, we get the US Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for April, which is expected to have declined to 88 from 120. On Wednesday, the central bank torch will be passed to the FOMC. This would be the first ordinary meeting since January, after which the committee decided to proceed with a number of stimulative measures, including cutting rates to the 0.025% range and unlimited amounts of QE purchases in order to support the US economy from the coronavirus damages. On March 26th, Fed Chair Powell highlighted that the Fed is not going to run out of ammunition in its attempts to stimulate the economy, but since then they announced programs considered as never seen before intervention into the US economy. The committee announced that it will purchase corporate bonds, backstop direct loans to companies, and that it will initiate a program to provide credit to small and medium-sized businesses. They also announced that they will purchase unlimited amount of treasuries and the agency mortgage-backed securities in order to allow proper functioning of the U.S. Debt market. With the Fed never been in favor of the negative rates regime, we can see here that the market is not anticipating such an action. So with that in mind, all the aforementioned measures make us believe that now there is little easing ammunition in the chamber, and thus policymakers may prefer to stand pat at this gathering and wait for a while to see whether the already adopted measures are having the desired effect on the economy. As for Wednesday's releases, during the Asian trading, Japanese markets will be closed due to the Shuwa day, but we get important data from New Zealand and Australia. Getting the ball rolling with New Zealand, we have the employment report for the first quarter and the trade balance for March. The unemployment rate is forecast to have increased to 4.2% from 4%, while the net change in employment is expected to have accelerated to 0.3% quarter over quarter from 0.2%. No forecast is available with regards to the nation's trade data. Now, on March 15th, the RBNZ proceeded with an emergency 75 basis points rate reduction, noting that the outlook has deteriorated significantly. Officials also added that the rate will stay at 0.25% at least for 12 months, meaning that there are no more cuts on the horizon. That said, officials agreed that should further stimulus be required, a large-scale asset purchase program would be preferable. Having said that, though, we don't believe that a QE program will be introduced at the upcoming gathering. Inflation accelerated to 2.5% in the first quarter from 1.9%, while a potential rise in the unemployment rate may be due to good reasons. After all, the new added jobs are expected to have accelerated, something suggesting that the increase in the unemployment rate may be due to more unemployed people actively looking for a job. Now, from Australia, we get inflation numbers for the first quarter. The headline rate is expected to have risen from 1.8% to 2%, which is the lower bound of the RBA's target range. That said, the trimmed mean and weighted mean rates are expected to have remained decently lower. The trimmed mean one is forecast to have held steady at 1.6% year over year, while the weighted one is forecast to have increased to 1.5 from 1.3. When they last met, Australian policymakers left monetary policy unchanged and offered some details with regards to their QE program. They noted that they will do what is necessary to achieve a three-year yield target of 0.25%, with the target expected to remain in place until progress is being made towards the goals of full employment and inflation. However, they added that if conditions continue to improve, it is likely that smaller and less frequent purchases of government bonds will be required. Now, after saying that interest rates have reached their effective lower bound at the previous meeting, the aforementioned points suggest that there is very little chance of expanding their QE program. On the contrary, they could soon scale it back if the spreading of the coronavirus continues to level off. Thus, slightly better inflation numbers are unlikely to make RBA policymakers change their minds. We believe that in order for that to happen, the spreading of the pandemic may have to get out of control again. The Aussie could gain somewhat on the better data, but in the broader picture, it may be another victim of the changes in the overall investor morale. And during the European morning, Germany's CPIs for April are coming out. Both the CPI and the HICP rates are forecast to have slid notably to 0.5% year over year and 0.6% year over year from 1.4% and 1.3% respectively. So this would add speculation that the headline CPI rate for the Eurozone as a whole, due out on Thursday, may follow suit. Now, in the US, apart from the FOMC decision, we get the preliminary GDP print for the first quarter. Expectations are for a 4% quarter over quarter contraction after a 2.1% expansion in the last 3 months of 2019. Now, a shrinking US economy would be a surprise to no one, given the fast spreading of the coronavirus in the US during the last month of the quarter. That said, it would be interesting to see how deep the wounds have been. According to the Atlanta GDP Now and the New York Nowcast models, the economy contracted only 0.3 and 0.4% respectively, something that shifts the risks of the official forecast to the upside. Now moving to Thursday. On Thursday, we have another central bank deciding on monetary policy, and this is the ECB. Last Thursday, preliminary data revealed that the euro area manufacturing PMI fell to 33.6 from 44.5, hitting its lowest since February 2009, while the services index fell to 11.7, its lowest ever, dragging the composite PMI down to 13.5 from 29.7. Now, despite the recent signs that the pandemic may be leveling off, these data suggest that Eurozone's economic outlook continued to deteriorate at the beginning of the second quarter of the year, and it remains to be seen whether this, combined with a potential slowdown in inflation, will prompt the ECB to expand further its stimulus efforts. Just for the record, a couple of weeks ago, President Christine Lagarde said that she and her colleagues are committed to doing everything within their mandate to fight the crisis. Now, as for Thursday's data during the Asian session, we get Japan's preliminary industrial production and retail sales, both for March. Industrial production is anticipated to have declined 5.2% month over month after sliding 0.3% in February, while retail sales are forecast to have fallen 4.7% after rising 1.6%. China's official PMIs for April are also coming out, but no forecast is currently available. Following the slowdown and the stabilization of the coronavirus in China since March, we wouldn't be surprised if the PMIs reveal another month of expansion in both the manufacturing and services sectors. Now, during the European Day, Eurozone's preliminary CPI for April and the bloc's first estimate of GDP for the first quarter are due to be released just a few hours before the ECB decision. Both the headline and core CPI rates are expected to have tumbled to 0.1% year over year and 0.7% year over year from 0.7 and 1% respectively, while the GDP data are anticipated to show that the euro area economy has shrunk 3.2% quarter over quarter after expanding only 0.1% in the last 3 months of 2019. The case for a notable slide in euro area inflation is supported by the potential decline in Germany's inflation on Wednesday, while taking into account the fast spreading of the coronavirus, a contracting economy is nothing but a given for the financial community. Therefore, we believe that euro traders may focus more on the ECB's response to the damages caused by the pandemic rather than the data itself. From the US, we get personal income and spending data for March alongside the core PCE index for the month, while from Canada, we get the monthly GDP rate for February. Both the US personal income and spending are expected to have declined 1.5% month over month and 5% month over month from 0.6 and 0.2% respectively. While no forecast is available for the core PCE index, which stood at 1.8% in February, Canada's GDP is anticipated to have grown 0.1% month over month, the same pace as in February. Now, finally, on Friday is a labor day in several nations under our radar. We only get data from Japan, the UK, and the US. During the Asian morning, the Tokyo CPIs are due to be released, with the core rate expected to have slid to 0.1% year over year from 0.4%. No forecast is available for the headline rate. Later in the day, the final UK manufacturing PMI for March is expected to be revised down to 32.8 from 32.9. While in the US, the ISM manufacturing index for the month is forecast to have declined to 36.7 from 49.1. The final market manufacturing PMI is also coming out, but as it is always the case, it is expected to confirm its preliminary estimate of 36.9. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. Do we have any questions with regards to this week's economic data or releases or central bank decisions? Okay, it seems that we don't have any. Okay, thank you very much for watching and listening. If you are interested in more detail, in a more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time. So goodbye. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday.
JFT, just fair and direct.